In this video, we're given an Atwood machine that has a bit of a complication. So I have a horizontal track with a cart rolling along with wheels that are essentially frictionless. But that cart has a block stacked on top of it. And that block will accelerate together with the cart, held in place by static friction. And we get into the details in parts C and D to compute the friction force that it feels and the minimum coefficient of static friction to keep it in place. But part A is a pretty standard Atwood machine question. I want the acceleration of the system and the tension in the string. And the key to this is to realize that provided the block doesn't slip, those two masses on the track move as one mass that has a mass of 650 grams or 0.650 kilograms. I'll go ahead and convert the mass of the hanging mass as well. That's 0.355 kilograms. And then to solve the Atwood machine, we get into the standard force diagrams. The hanging mass feels a force of mg pulling down. That's the force of gravity. I crunch the numbers real quick because I have plenty of room in my diagram. 0.355 times 9.8. And this gives me 3.479 newtons. The other force felt by that mass is the tension in the string pulling up. And I'm intentionally showing that vector shorter than the weight vector because I know the weight is bigger than the tension because I know that block is accelerating downward. And as usual, provided the pulley is light and frictionless, the tension will be the same everywhere in the string. So that cart with the block on top also feels a tension of T, and that's pulling to the right. It's clear that the Atwood machine is going to accelerate in this direction where the hanging mass goes down and the cart goes to the right. And we're going to define that as the positive direction for the analysis of forces on each of these masses. Next, we apply Newton's second law to each of these masses. Again, we're treating the block on the cart as a single 0.650 kilogram mass. So for the 0.650 kilogram mass, if I look at the net force in the x direction, that's just T. And that's equal to the mass of that object times the acceleration of that object. And if I plug in the mass of that object, I arrive at my first equation. T equals 0.650 times A. Then I look at the hanging mass, 0.355 kilograms, and it has two forces acting on it. And again, downward is going to be the positive direction for the hanging mass because I want the acceleration to come out to be a positive number in both of these equations. And I know the actual acceleration is downward. So mg counts as a positive, and the t will count as a negative. That's pointed in the negative direction. And that's equal to the size of that mass multiplied by its acceleration. So I plug in the numbers, and I have 3.479 newtons. Pointed down minus a T pointed up. That's equal to the size of that mass, which is 0.355 times its acceleration. Again, this is just applying Newton's second law, F equals ma, to each individual moving piece of the Atwood machine. So now I have two equations and two unknowns. I have T equals 0.650A and 3.479 minus T equals 0.355A. And using elimination is the quickest way to solve this system of equations. If I add the left-hand sides, the t's are going to cancel. And that gives me a 3.479. And then if I add the right-hand sides, I get 0.650a plus 0.355a. And this gives me 1.005 times a. Now I can solve for the acceleration. And I get 3.46 meters per second squared. Now, one sort of crude check that you can always do on your work is to verify that your acceleration is less than free fall. Because for the hanging mass, the fastest it could ever fall is free fall, but there's a tension pulling up on it and is slowing it down. So we at least pass that test. Next, we get the tension in the string. And I can go back to either one of the original equations to get this done. I'm going to go back to the first one because it's the simplest. So T is equal to 0.650 times A. And now I have A. And I get a tension of 2.25 newtons. Now in part C, we start to zoom in and focus on this 200 gram block that's being dragged along by the force of friction. If there was no friction force, that block would just stay at the same x coordinate and the cart would slip out from underneath it. And the reason it's accelerating with the cart is that there's a static friction force pointing to the right. And that static friction force depends on the normal force and that depends on the weight of that block. So I have a weight of that little block of mg, so 0.2 kilograms times 9.8 meters per second squared. And this gives me 1.96 newtons. There's nothing else going on in the vertical direction. And I know this thing has a zero vertical acceleration. So the normal force must balance the weight. So the normal force must be 1.96. Okay, so rereading the question in part C, I want the friction force on the block. And I know the acceleration of the block because it's accelerating with the cart, and that's 3.46 meters per second squared. And I know the mass of that little block, that's 0.200 kilograms. And the only force acting horizontally on that block is the static friction force. So I can write down Newton's second law, F net equals ma. If you like, you could specify we're talking about the x direction net force here. And there's only one force, it's the static friction force. And that's equal to the mass of the block times its acceleration, which is 3.46 meters per second squared. And I find that the static friction force is 0.0692 newtons. Finally, in part D, we're asked to get the minimum coefficient of static friction so the block won't slip. So if we pull too hard on that cart, it'll slip out from underneath that block, just like pulling out the tablecloth from beneath the dishes. We're trying to figure out how big does that static friction coefficient have to be to keep this thing locked in place, accelerating with the cart. And so the key physical assumption here is to assume that the static friction force is maxed out. In other words, we're right at the edge of where any faster acceleration would cause it to break loose. So we're assuming the static friction coefficient is small enough that our static friction force is at its maximum possible value as the Atwood machine accelerates. And there's a nice little formula, of course, for the maximum static friction. That's mu s times the normal force. Well, we have the static friction force and we have the normal force, so now we can solve for the coefficient of static friction. So that's going to be a 0.692 newtons. And the normal force was already computed, that's 1.96 newtons. And I get a static friction coefficient of 0.353. But the reason this is the minimum static friction coefficient is that if it got any smaller than 0.353, I wouldn't be able to produce this static friction force that I measured in part C. It would require more than the maximum possible, and the thing would break loose and slip off the back of the cart. If you enjoyed this video or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left, or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.